Well, welcome back to our study of 2 Timothy, Paul's second letter to his very close friend, his protege, his ambassador, whom he has left in the city of Ephesus to look over and manage the churches in Ephesus, which were having a great deal of trouble. False teaching was coming in, and we talked about that a great deal in his first letter to Timothy. But when we come to 2 Timothy, perhaps 2, maybe 3 years later, Paul is in a Roman prison. He's nearing the end of his life. He doesn't know exactly when that's going to happen, but he knows it's going to happen. So of all the people that Paul could have written to or communicated with, he wanted to write one more time to his very close friend Timothy. So what we have in this letter called 2 Timothy is a very personal, very intimate display of affection, display of instructions. Last-minute details of things that he wants Timothy to be aware of before Paul leaves this earth. But in all of it is just a very warm, very affectionate type of letter. So when we began our study in 2 Timothy, we worked through a number of sections in the first chapter and into the second chapter and just looked at things that Paul remembered about Timothy and reminded him about Timothy that he wanted him to do. He had to remind Timothy, don't be ashamed, that while many people had left Paul behind, he did not want Timothy to forget about him or to be ashamed about Paul or about the gospel. In fact, he wanted him to be strengthened because that there were other people who were serving faithfully, and he encouraged him to say, Timothy, like a soldier, like an athlete, like a farmer, you need to take advice from all of these kinds of people, and you need to continue to serve with courage. Well, when we come to today, it's time to talk about another piece of this letter. We're in chapter 2, verses 8 through 13. And sometimes distractions come and they want to divert us off of the path of following Jesus Christ. Let me give you an example. A couple of years ago when I was preaching in our church, something happened while I was preaching. In our particular church, behind me, we have a video screen. And we have the words, or certain, we call it PowerPoint is the program. And behind me are key words for the sermon. And so it'll be like slides changing and the picture changing. Well, as I was preaching and my focus was on the people here, behind me, everyone was seeing the screen go blank. But it didn't just go blank. The computer that was running the pictures behind me started to crash. So they saw the computer shutting down. They saw the image go away. They saw messages on the screen. And all of this was happening behind me. And you say, well, it's a good thing you didn't see it. But I did. Because in our church, we have a second screen. It's a smaller one, and it's in the back of our sanctuary. And it's up high so that I can see what is being projected behind me. So as I'm preaching, as I'm trying to talk, I'm watching the screen in front of me. I'm seeing the picture go away. I'm seeing the computer shut down. I see the blue screen. I see the people in our video booth scrambling and running around trying to get, and I'm trying to talk. And it is incredibly distracting. And I'm like, how am I supposed to do this? And I had notes in front of me, so I'm trying to look at my notes, but I'm trying to pretend that nothing is happening, even though my mind is racing 100 different directions. And so the distraction forced me to narrow my focus to focus very closely on what I was trying to say. I use that example because we all face distractions in life in so many different ways. Maybe you're working at a job and you're trying to do your job and the boss asks you to do this. At the same time, you're doing this and you're thinking about this. Or maybe you're in a classroom at the university or in school. And you're working on your assignment, and one of your friends says, I need to talk to you now, or can you help me with my homework in a different subject? And you're going here and here and here. Or maybe you're a parent, or maybe you're in your marriage relationship, and there's children, and there's distractions, and you're saying, I just want to manage my home well, and I don't know how to focus my attention. All of us face the problem of distractions. It's part of life. But what do we do? When distractions come, and there are many things piling up around us, what we need to do is focus on a small amount of things, maybe even one thing. And I would suggest to you that this is true, especially for the Christian. just because the Christian is a follower of Jesus Christ doesn't mean that there won't be distractions. In fact, it almost guarantees that there will be. So what happens when this situation happens, and this situation happens, and this situation happens? What do I do as a follower of Jesus Christ? I narrow my focus. Well, what do I narrow my focus on? As we're going to see in Paul's letter to Timothy, this second one today, in the second chapter, Paul is going to say to Timothy, I want you to narrow your focus on one thing, actually one person, the person of Jesus Christ. When I came to this section in my study and preparation, I looked at this section and I said, why is this here? Paul had been giving wonderful instruction. He'd been trying to be encouraging to Timothy. He'd said this and he'd encouraged this. And all of a sudden, here is a short section of verses that when I looked at it, I said, this doesn't make any sense. Paul, what were you thinking? Why would you put this here? It doesn't seem to fit. If you've ever put together a puzzle and all of the puzzle pieces fit together in a certain way, sometimes in our house, we'll have a puzzle and it'll sit out on the table and we'll work on it from time to time. And you come across this puzzle piece that no matter where you try to fit it, it doesn't fit. That's what I thought as I looked at this section. I said, Paul, what were you thinking? And then it occurred to me what I was just describing to you about distraction. I think that as he was thinking about Timothy and his situation in Ephesus with all these churches in this area and the false teaching that was coming in and all of the problems and Timothy's health and Timothy's perseverance, Timothy, maybe you're getting distracted. Timothy, I want you to focus on one thing. I know you're going to have to do this, 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 and this, but for a moment, Timothy, I want you to focus with me on one thing, one person. The person of Jesus Christ. The person of Jesus Christ. We're using the image in this particular letter of navigation. So we're a ship. Sometimes we steer towards things. Sometimes we steer away from things, dangerous icebergs. In this particular lesson, we're going to steer towards something. And I would suggest to you that the person we need to steer toward when life with all of its distractions happens is none other than Jesus Christ. So if you don't have your Bibles open already, please take them now and turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 13. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 8 through 13. Here's what it says. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore, I will endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. In these verses, I would suggest to you that the main point, especially as comes right from verse 8, is simply this. Timothy, remember Jesus Christ. Don't forget. Don't take your eyes off of the cross. Don't take your eyes off of what Jesus Christ did for you and for each and every one of us. Remember Jesus Christ. The word itself is in the present tense, which means it should go on and on and on. In other words, the idea would be keep on remembering. Keep trying to bring it into your mind to keep your focus. That gets so hard when we have distractions. Let me give you an example. I've talked several times about our 8-year-old daughter, Sasha. And everybody loves Sasha, but one of the problems that Sasha has is she is very easily distracted. What we've learned about Sasha is that you cannot give her 4 things to do at one time. For example, it's 9 o'clock in the evening, and it's time for her to go to bed. So if you say, Sasha, clean up your room, put on your pajamas, brush your teeth, and then come back and we'll pray before you go to bed. So I've given her 4 things. Clean your room, put on your pajamas, brush your teeth, and then come back and see me and I'll pray with you before you go to bed. If you were then to leave her and come back 30 minutes later, she wouldn't have done 4 things. She wouldn't have done 3 things. She wouldn't have done 2 things. She might have done 1 thing. because in her little 8-year-old brain, she's thinking about this, and she likes kitties and puppies, and she likes animals, and maybe she sees this, or maybe her brother did something here. And if you come back 30 minutes later and say, Sasha, I gave you 4 things to do. How many did you do? I say, did you clean your room? No, Dad. Did you put on your pajamas? And I can see that she didn't. No, Dad. Sasha, did you brush your teeth? No, Dad. Well, I know you didn't come here to pray. Sasha, what do I need to do? What do you need to do? I need to go clean my room. See, what we've learned with Sasha is we need to give her 1 or 2 things at a time to do. Because in her little 8-year-old mind, that's all that she can comprehend. Now, lest you think that this is only a problem for her, I have the same problem. My wife will call me at church and she say, Bruce, on your way home, could you stop by the grocery store and buy some bananas and some milk and maybe, I don't know, some lettuce? And I'll get done with work and I'll get in my car and I'll drive home and I'll come into the house and Trudy will say, did you get the groceries? I couldn't remember all that. See, I'm really no different than Sasha. It's because distractions come. Because when I got out of church and I got into my car, I was thinking about supper. I was thinking what I was going to do that evening, or maybe there was a meeting. I wasn't thinking about groceries. This is a problem that I think all of us have, from the youngest of us to the oldest of us. And what Paul is saying to Timothy, Timothy, with all the distractions around you, the problems in the church, the problems with leadership, the problems in the city, the problems with the Roman Empire, Timothy, focus on Jesus Christ. Remember Jesus Christ. Timothy, you must remember him. Well, what about Jesus Christ? There are 2 significant phrases here. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead. Remember how we've said over and over and over again, for Paul, it is always about the gospel. It's always about the gospel. That motivated him. That was his one thing that kept him going all the time. So when he talks about risen from the dead, he's talking about Jesus Christ's death. He's talking about his resurrection. If you recall some of his words to the Corinthian people, he said, listen, if the resurrection is not true, then we are of most of all people to be pitied for being fools. That if the resurrection of Jesus Christ is not true, we should go do something else, because all of Christianity collapses if the resurrection is not true. So Timothy, as you remember and narrow your focus, remember Jesus Christ and how significant his death and his resurrection were. But there's another phrase. It says, the offspring of David. I said, well, why would he talk about being the offspring of David? Yes, I know he came from the tribe of Judah. And yes, I know that he was a descendant of David. What Paul is emphasizing here is the humanity of Jesus Christ. Hey, Timothy, you're a human being. You feel insecure. You feel weak. You feel many things. Timothy, Jesus Christ was a human being too. He was fully God and he was fully man, but Timothy, he suffered like us. Temptations came at him like us. He struggled with the variety of people that came against him like us. He was fully man, Timothy. He understands. So when you remember Jesus Christ, understand that Jesus Christ understands you, and that can inform your faith, your endurance, your patience, your perseverance.
While we continue being a benevolent project, your kind donations will continue to be vital in fulfilling the calling of TVS Ministry. We do count on your gracious support and cooperation. For detailed information, visit www.tvseminary.com. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 10, 11. How to give to TVS Ministry. You may give online at efta.org/givenow. In the description place, write Russia Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. or make checks out to EFCA, right on the check memo line, Russian Distance Learning, account number 24109-0150. Mail to EFCA Donor Services, 901 East 78th Street, Minneapolis, Minnesota, 55420-1300. Or send your gift through PayPal for tvs.gift@gmail.com.